I'm Associate Professor of Music Education here at Duquesne. Welcome to our school here in class. I am also on the advisory board for the Honors College Fellows Program. And as you can see in the program, and as you'll see tonight, Julie has had a wonderful experience that she'd like to share with you. The committee meets a few times a year to review applications for their fellow program, and it's kind of a way to enhance the students in the Honors College, enhance their learning, give them opportunities to further a specific area of interest to them that is not necessarily available nearby or is not available in the regular curriculum. So those that seek that out tend to have the most interesting proposals, and it's only 1% of the graduating class at Duquesne that is an Honors College Fellow. So I'm just going to let Julie continue with her program and or start with the program.
Okay.
And don't worry about the technology, we're all really patient. And just say thank you to her for a wonderful proposal. And I enjoyed reading it, especially since I'm with the School of Music. And I would also like to say thank you to Dr. Sheehan and Dr. Hinson, who have advised her through this, and Dr. Roberts, who couldn't be here, which is why I'm giving this speech, and hers is a lot, she's quicker with the information. But thank you very much, and we're looking forward to hearing about your trip.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Julie Ching. I was the 2017 Endowed Fellow in African Studies and Creative Arts. My project idea was basically just that anytime African music comes up, people either don't know what it is or they think it's just drumming. They're like, oh yeah, drumming, and that's part of it, but it's not the whole thing. And so there are like string and wind and brass instruments in Africa that people don't know about, and they can't really be faulted for not knowing about something that is not really taught in American schools. But I think that reducing African music to drumming or even racist stereotypes, sometimes people would say, I feel like that affects our perception of Africa as this primitive place, this this like desolate, uneducated place where people have AIDS and no food and stuff like that. And I really wanted to show that their music is just as intricate and intellectual as Western art music. And part of it was that Dr. Sheehan introduced me to this instrument. It's called the tora, and it's a 21-string double bridge harp, meaning that it has two rows of strings that are suspended over this bridge. So this instrument is really ingenious in a lot of ways because it's so, there's nothing here that really costs very much money. This calabash here, it's a dry board instrument. It's a lot like a pumpkin, basically. And then you have wooden posts, and these strings are actually made of fishing line. So whereas we have usually like metal or synthetic material in like violin and viola strings, these are just like plastic. I actually have some. I should probably pass them around. If you want to play with this, it's just I proposed my project, and the Honors College was gracious enough to grant it to me. So last summer, I spent 5 weeks in Dakar, Senegal. That's a picture. In Africa, the capital of Senegal. I actually stayed in Yoga. would turn it on and nothing would come out. It's incredibly frustrating to get in the shower, turn the water on, and nothing comes out. But there was a period of 3 days where we didn't have running water, and that was just normal that it would just fizzle in and out like that. And so having like a little bucket of standing water was nice even for times like that. I couldn't drink the tap water, obviously, so I would buy these like 10-liter giant things of water. And here's just like a little bit like outside of the house I was staying in. You can see it's like a very, like a different world almost. Yeah, I was fascinated by like the goats running around. Like, we don't really see that here. And this is from the rooftop of the house I was staying in. You can kind of see just sort of like infrastructure. There was this mosque here. It's a sound, I guess. But the mosque wasn't too far away, so often I would wake up or something and there would be singing that was broadcast through loudspeakers through the whole village. Yost is a seaside town, so I was literally only like 15 minutes away from the beach. This is my host brother, Yuzen. This picture really encapsulates our whole relationship really well, actually. he was very, very nice to me. Even when I did some like silly touristy things. It was a very, very big family with lots and lots of children. And this was my brother, Max, who, Max means a lot to me in a lot of ways. I didn't even know that Max existed before I went to Senegal. I knew about the other family members. But Max accompanied me almost everywhere and served as a translator. Senegal is a francophone country. And I had taken a semester of French before I went, but a semester of French is not a lot of French. So he accompanied me. He speaks English, French, Wolof, and I think another language fluently. So he accompanied me almost everywhere and served as a translator. He's holding my purse there, but he wouldn't let me hold anything. He's just very, very nice. But the whole reason I came was to play the kora, obviously. And there's this family of koras, the Sisuku family, who I met. And they had several instruments. I want to show you this video. But I guess it's, whatever. So the way, this is a traditional landing instrument where the music is passed down from generation to generation. There's no system of notation. In fact, my teachers asked me if I could teach them to read and write music, which I I tried to do as much as I could while I was there. They're very fast learners and everything. It was just amazing to me that these people with all of these melodies in their head have no system, notation, don't know how to read and write music. I mean, really, really fantastic musicians, and I wish I could play sound and could hear my teachers play. But the way this instrument and this music is sort of set up is the left thumb. Okay, so you hold it with three fingers on each post, and you're gonna play with these four, I guess, fingers. Thumbs aren't really fingers, but the left thumb plays a bass line, an ostinato, which repeats over and over and over, and the right thumb plays an accompaniment ostinato, which repeats over and over and over, and then that leaves your four fingers to improvise on top. So, I guess I can show you how something sort of builds up. Here's the bass line. he's a very classical kora player, and he's who I studied with primarily. He's kind of a big deal, so he went on tour to France while I was still there, and I was like, okay. So I studied with El Haji, his younger brother, while he was in Paris, and El Haji is a little younger, I think 6 years younger, and El Haji introduced me to a very interesting, like, modern kora play, where they sometimes drop these bass lines and stuff, and they just sort of go nuts with their index fingers. So that song was called Bani, and that's a song about gold. So a variation that El Haji taught me, I can't really play it that well, but I'll play it the traditional way, I guess, a couple times, and then sort of show you what El Haji did that was sort of more like a pop music thing.
Thank you. take to build one of those?
They only took like 4 or 5 days to do it, but they may have been able to do it faster. I don't know if some people would take longer to do it. I don't know, really. But they only took 4 or 5 days to do it. I remember when the cowhide, this is cowhide that stretched over the calabash, was still wet. I think it took a while for them to wait for it to dry, stuff like that. But otherwise, it's a pretty simple instrument. This is a haji, actually. This is Okar. So within 4 or 5 days, the instrument is done. I have this great video of the haji playing it. This next song is called Carafa, and it's about a legendary Mandane war general. I'm not sure, it wasn't entirely clear to me whether or not he was a real person, but supposedly he fought a deciding battle in some ancient war, and so a lot of the war literature is about or dedicated to him. And so this is just the general song, I guess.
Thank you.
because there's no notation system for these melodies and I'm prone to forget, I actually wrote them according to our Western music notation. And it was really interesting to me. I could be wrong, of course, but Jarabi seemed to be the only one of the pieces that I learned that was in a strange time signature. And I felt like that was maybe the heartbeat thing going on. Like, something like, I don't know. It's just, I feel like that's a very, very expressive piece. So there are multiple tunings. This is currently tuned to like a C major scale in the Western tradition. I think there are 5 or 6 scales. What we regard as the C major scale, they call the sauta tuning. And I learned a few more pieces in the syllaba tuning, which is basically analogous to F major, I guess. It's just B flat is added. So I'm actually gonna lower my B strings right now. Changing this one pitch really changes the color of the instrument overall, I feel like. This next piece I'm about to play is called Amba, and that means the great Karama. So it's about the war general and everything. And I actually think it sounds very much like a Christmas song, but you see what you think. Pull the thumbs together, I guess. And a real point of pride for me was this last piece, Kurutu Karefa, which means, again, the great Karefa, but apparently with a stronger connotation of greatness. So they were saying that they had never taught this piece to a foreigner before, and that there are professional chorists who can't play this, which I was, I don't know. I can play it, but I can't improvise on it, so I'll just play it for, like, I don't know, like 15 seconds. It gets boring after a while, you know?
Imagining in my head
our music education students learning about this instrument from you. So I hope you'll continue to educate us, and you'll be hearing from me.
Okay.
Because I'll want you to continue this. And I'm really inspired by my colleagues and their influence and your influence on this room tonight and just our community at Duquesne. So I'm sorry I'm so emotional, but I'm also very excited because I have a medal for Julie as an endowed, I keep getting the words mixed up, endowed fellow with the Honors College at Duquesne University. Do you like me to?
West Africa. So it is, we think of it as an American instrument, but he was sort of trying to find where the area where the slaves had sort of brought that idea and knowledge from. So it sort of is connected very deeply to Africa. And that the album is called Throw Down Your Harp. It's an amazing album. It's he collaborates with all these African musicians. So it's sort of exactly what you're saying.
Awesome.
Sorry. I have a colleague who's just written his dissertation on this, actually. It actually derives from the akontang, which is a kind of similar string instrument to this one, but it's actually played like a guitar, and it's from Senegal, from West Africa. And they've kind of traced it back to that specific instrument. But there's a bunch of different instruments, like I was saying, they go in lots of different shapes, like oval shapes. But they say that the akontang is the banjo present.
I think it's different from the core.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a
couple
of pictures of it here too. It's kind of strong, like what banjo would be. Same thing, these boards, they have the cowhide for it. Yeah.
Is there more questions for Julie?
Sorry.
Are the tuning knobs from, they put those on while they, when they built them for you?
Yeah. But this is a modern kora, so the tuning machines are, you know, Western, and they have access to them there. They can buy them in Senegal. So this is the original system that was put on my Cora when it was built. But traditionally, it was just a post like this, and they would line the string around and around and around, and they would change the pitch by moving the bundle like up or down. As you can imagine, that's a lot more frustrating to tune than with machines. So supposedly, a lot of purists say that the traditional Cora has a more resonant sound, it projects better, but a lot of cores prefer to use the tuning machines. So.
What is it adorned with?
Oh, so I think you actually figured out that they're, they seem to be nails, actually. I thought they were just beads, but it does go through all the way, and it is holding the cowhide, if you can see. Mm. So it's really interesting. What I saw in Senegal often was that people would sort of like go nuts with the decorations on here. They would put like their name, they would draw pictures with things, and
yeah, the other ones are like really intricate with like swirl patterns.
Yeah, some of these are like carved really beautifully. Yeah, they were a little lazy on this, but that's okay.
Well, I just want to say, I mean, I actually lived in Senegal for 7 years, so thank you for the pictures and the memories and the sounds. And I just had a little reaction when you say just drumming, like drumming and of course when you say Africa, like this huge vast array of cultures, like drumming is also very intricate, even in itself. Like I would just, to me, it's not like even just drumming, but you know, drumming is an intricate, useful form that is often performed by itself, and it also can be reused. Like, in addition to the amazing array of drummers and drumming styles and drums that they have, like, that's a whole entire, you know, I just had this little...
Oh, no, you're absolutely right. I apologize for that. I did,
That's okay.
When I went to Ghana before I went to Senegal, yeah. Actually, with Joe, and, we studied drumming there, and that was like
amazing.
Yeah.
Cool.
It's definitely. I know that it's incredibly. Yeah. Complex. It's just. I don't know. Even in orchestral setting, we associate percussionists with sort of like a lower intelligence. That it's just like it's simpler because it's just rhythm. But it's still incredibly valid and important and difficult.
I don't think of that.
Yeah.
And you're a musician, so you don't have. Thanks.
Thank you.
I think it's marvelous that there's a place in the world where beautiful music is passed down from one place to another. And there are so many places in the world where that happens, because it's you know, this intimate connection just between you know your heart and soul and the instrument. And you know, and that's conveyed from one person to another. And you know, that's how a lot of string band music is also passed down from one person to another. And I you know, it's written down, and I found myself in the last song especially counting, oh wow, that happens every 8 feet, repeats.
Yeah.
and looking for a beat part that's not there. But you know, I would like to listen to more of this music. So that I'm not, you know, westernizing my listening. It's beautiful to have my music to play from this instrument.
Thank you. Actually, I know at least Jeremy does have a B part that I'm not comfortable playing yet. But it does have a B part, so I'm not sure what other pieces that I know have B parts that I just don't know about. But it is surprisingly closer to us than we would expect.
You might be interested in a book called Hoedowns, Jigs, and Frolics by a banjo player from North Carolina. Hoedowns, Jigs, and Frolics. His name is Phil Jameson. And he's recently written this book and presented it at the Appalachian String Band Festival in West Virginia to folks who play this music. And he beats out a lot of these myths about the banjo and myths about how African music developed in the United States. Really interesting. Bill Jameson.
Obviously, from your write-up, you're also very familiar, very skilled on the violin. You find yourself transferring any of these melodies that you have in your head from the
yeah, perhaps, definitely.
And duets, just doing wonderful things with some of these elements, because they're absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, it's definitely, I mean, because I had to memorize everything on this instrument, I found that memorizing things on other, like violin, for instance, memorizing things on other things became easier too, so skills do transfer.